we're doing it today. Because I believe in a supernatural God who does supernatural things. We don't have any overheads today. We don't have a computer that runs it. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? We just need the power of God. That's all we need. If the lights go off, we'll meet in the parking lot and drag a chair, each person out. We don't need anything but a shade tree and the Bible to get through today to worship and praise the Lord. And we are going to do everything that we can do to bring honor and glory to His name. And we're going to believe in faith for healings and in believing for God to use His Word to do marvelous changes in our lives. Thank you for your patience. You can be seated. Thanks for adding your faith to ours. Amen. I think we're going to go into our time, continue our worship with our offering. And who is Ryan? Orion. Where is Orion? Hey, what structure and administrative strong points are necessary for the continuation, the framework of a service like that? But what is a service that doesn't have something that comes from the heart? What is a service that doesn't have the arts represented in that kind of great song? And we can brag on it. You give God the glory, but we thank you for that. Good job. Good job. I love that, and please do more of that. We want to dismiss our kids to children's ministry at this time. So we're just going to, if your eyes are open, you just, if you're walking, keep your eyes open. And I'm going to pray for you. Father, I just pray you bless our ministers that minister our children today, Father. I pray, Lord, that this be, Lord, a fun, not a burden, Lord, but an opportunity to serve you and worship and praise you today. I pray you'd fill them with your Spirit, Lord, and may they minister in power. Bless our children as they receive your word, Lord. May they grow up to be strong citizens of the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name. Everybody said? Amen. Amen. Good word. Thank you so much. We miss anything? Oh, we got to preach yet. I forgot. Yeah. No. Yeah, like I forgot that. Yeah. if you have not received but want a copy of this week's notes, would you raise your hand? There were quite a few around, and I think Trevor's going to, there's a couple here in the front row, one here in the middle, if you could just serve these. Just keep your hand up until you are served. It's not so important that you fill in the blanks on these, but rather that you have the scriptures to take home with you, because I'm going to feed you a lot of scripture. I did last week, we're going to continue through today, and we'll see if I get done with it this week. But I want you to be able to take these scriptures home with you, to meditate on them, to think about them. And as you are challenged, hopefully, that you'll go and say, let me see that again. Let me see what God would say to me through this. So last week, I began preaching a message about, it was called, Does God Want Me to Be Blessed? Yes. And the answer was right there in the title. I didn't get that far through it yet, but I just wanted to go ahead and pick up right there. Now, the word of the Lord in my thoughts for this, and the reason why He doesn't want me to be in a hurry on this message, isn't necessarily because Steve Goodner, Pastor Steve, wants to be known as a prosperity preacher. It's not because I want to begin to hit you up about offering, and you'll notice in these messages I'm not saying much about giving in the offering, although that is certainly a part of blessing. But it's because I want the Lord to soak into your spirit who you are in Him. Because if the word of God, and the word really that comes to my mind is marinate. Anybody ever marinate beef? You know, if you're, you know, I don't know if you marinate veggies or not, you know, but if you do, they're probably good. But I don't marinate. I don't cook like that well. But I did fry some bacon yesterday morning. You know, let me just talk about bacon. You know, things that mean something you can relate to. I fried some bacon and I fried a couple of eggs in the bacon. Anybody ever do that? You know, just get that big old thing of bacon grease popping in, you know, making a mess, and then crack the eggs in there. And then actually, what I did was I cooked the eggs first, and I thought, hey, there's bacon in here. Score! So I grabbed the bacon, and there was about a half pound left, and I started frying that up. I'd already fried my eggs; I had to pull them out of the way. Then about the time all the bacon was just about done and I realized I had to feed more than just myself with that, and that I wasn't going to get as much as I wanted, I thought, ooh, there's those eggs. Let me pop them babies back in the pan and let them marinate in some of that bacon grease a little bit. What happens when you marinate something? It begins to soak up the flavor. you spend time in that environment when you're marinating. You're just in there. I'm just imagining being a piece of meat for a second, you know. I'm just laying in the pan, you know, and I'm just soaking in all that good flavor. What's the point of that? Is it because we have good flavor we need to get rid of? No. It's not to get rid of the flavoring, but rather so that the flavoring penetrates whatever it's soaking and marinating into, to the point that whenever you cook it and cut it and eat it, you taste the flavor of that marinade and is permeated throughout the meat. It's not just sprinkled on top. It's not just a quick whiff as you go through it. It's not just the first taste you get. But as you begin to chew on that meat, as you begin to work your way through that good stuff, you find the flavor of that beginning to just come out more and more and more and more. That's what the Word of God needs to do in our hearts as it relates to the message here. This is not something we just need to say one quick message on God wants you blessed to move on. But rather that we become a people who begin to understand that God wants to bless you because He loves you. Where we begin to let the Word and the Scriptures that we're talking about this morning soak in us. And we don't get in a big hurry to get past them because we just want to think about that Word a little bit longer and let it stew, let the juices begin to just open up in us a little bit, to begin to penetrate within our thinking and within who we are, so that we, after soaking in the marinade of the Word of God, it begins to penetrate us and begins to become a part of us, so that when we are, I don't know, consumed, eaten, whatever, that we begin to give the flavor of what we've been soaking in. And so it is with this word of blessing that God wants to bless you with. There is plenty of time for me to stand up here and give you messages where you go, ooh, that hurt, but it was good. Oh, man, that was bad. I needed that, you know. There's plenty of time for that. Can we just soak and marinate in some good stuff for a couple of weeks, though? It's the beginning of the year. And sometimes people say, man, I'm so glad last year is gone. I could use a little bit of good news. This is good news. There's some good news we need to soak in. And yeah, there's time for the yeah buts. There's always going to be time for the yeah but this and yeah but that. But let's just check those at the door for a few minutes and just let the truth of the blessing of the Word of God begin to soak into who we are. I was finished last week speaking about if you have the outline in your hand, it was, I guess, number 3 there. It was when Moses spoke. Then Moses spoke, the blessing would come to those who obey God's word. And there was a long paragraph in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 10 through 19, about all the ways that God wanted to bless His people. And we learned last week, and I won't rehash it, that we, as Christians, are the inheritors of the blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob by faith. And that because of Christ Jesus, we inherit all of those blessings. So as it talks about those things, I just kind of underlined and circled some of the things this morning that we read in Deuteronomy 6 last week. Some of those things says, cities that you did not build, houses full of good things, wells which you did not dig. He says there were requirements for it, is that we use the Word of God, that we listen to the Word of God, that we soak in the Word of God. It says, if you fear the Lord, if you serve the Lord, if you do things in His name, if you keep His commandments, if you do what His commandments are, if you do what is right and good. He says that I'm going to cast out your enemies. He says, let's see some things here. Blessing shall come upon you and overtake you. And we talked about chasing you down, and I illustrated that by giving Pastor Mike a kiss on the cheek there last week, which he was taken aback by. And he says, blessed shall you be in the city, blessed shall you be in the country, blessed shall be the fruit of your body, which is children, blessed shall be the produce of the ground, which is your job, and the increase of your herd, the increase of your cattle, of your offspring, of your flock, blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Your basket and your kneading bowl. To me, those are the man-made things that are the tools that we use to be able to do what God wants us to do. He said, I'm going to bless your children, I'm going to bless your job,
I'm going to bless those intangibles, but even your hardware, you know, I'm going to bless. You know? When your truck breaks down, it's going to be in the driveway, not out on 995 somewhere. You know what I mean? I mean, stuff like that. Yeah, your tire is flat at home, right? Not blowing out on the way. And thank God that you're here this morning. You missed the opportunity to read the scripture this morning, to Dan and Ken, but
I'm sure you knew I wasn't trying to skip out.
He says, blessed is your basket and your kneading bowl. And he goes on to say, that your enemies will be defeated before your face, blessing on you and your storehouses and all that you set your hand to, and he will bless you in the land of the Lord your God that he has given you. I'm looking at verse 8 right now in Deuteronomy. In the land. What does that mean, in the land? He says, if you go into this land and possess the good things that I have for you, then I will bless you in all of the fruit of that land. I'll bless you in your kneading bowls if you need stuff after you. I don't know what kneading really is. Big kind of mixing bowl. He says, I'm going to do all that stuff, and I'm going to do it in the land. Why in the land? Because that is the place of blessing. That's where the will of the Lord is for you. He says, when you get in my will, and my will is my word, when you begin to live your life according to the words that are written in the word of God, when you get into that promised land and you begin to dwell in that, he says, in that setting, I will bless you. In the land that your Lord, your God, is giving you, according to his plan for us, God's plan is blessing for you. And verse 9 says, the Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself. It says, the enemies shall be afraid of you. Drop down verse 12. It says, the Lord will open to you his good treasure. Woo-hoo! What do I imagine? Imagine Mel Fisher's treasure trove from the bottom of the sea over there, you know, from the treasure ship to Yatosha down in the Keys, where the largest load of gold and silver was ever found up to that point. And the underwater something treasure from an old Spanish galleon. I'm imagining God opening up a treasure chest and finding lots of gold and jewels. But then he explains what his treasure looks like. He says, the Lord will open you his good treasure, the heavens, to give you rain. Rain? Rain? Everybody, it's rain. I want the money. Show me the money, God. And he's like, I got something better than money. I got rain. If there's no rain, then there's no blessing on the crops. If there's no crops, there's nothing to eat. If there's nothing to eat, what are you going to do with all that money? The Lord will open you his good treasure. Treasure that he thinks is to be treasure. There are times when you really just need to walk outside in the rain and just stop a minute and just soak in it a second. And I'm going to get a cold and don't do stupid things. You know what I mean? But just stop for a moment and say, thank you, Lord, for the wealth of the rain that fills our lakes and makes our fishing good and keeps my grass green and cools down the temperature so I don't have to run my electric bill so much. Thank you for the blessing of rain. It's out of his treasure. He will open his good treasure, the heavens, to give you rain on your land in its season and bless you with all the work of your hand. You shall lend to many nations. And you shall not borrow. That's the treasure of the Lord, is that we would be out of debt. Oh man, if I was only out of debt. Who did that? That you signed on the dotted line somewhere. We need to learn to live according to his principles. I'm probably going to do another Dave Ramsey course soon about financial relief, how to get out of debt, how to live debt free, how to be free from that kind of bondage. He says that's the blessing of Abraham, is to be able to lend to many nations but not have to borrow. The Lord will make you the head and not the tail. He'll make you the head and not the tail. There's always in some family, there's kind of like the matriarch, or the head of the family, the patriarch, the person maybe that everybody kind of looks to say where we're going to be the next holidays or who's going to make the decisions about family matters. God wants that to be you. Now, is it your turn yet? I don't know. But I do know that God wants you to have the blessing. He wants you to be the head and not the tail. He wants you to be the thinker and the leader and not the one who has to come up at the end. He says the head, not the tail. You'll be above only and not beneath. If you heed the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today, are careful to observe them. Now, we spoke last week about the fact that we can't keep all the Old Testament commandments anyway. We're doomed before we get started. So how is a blessing going to come to us? Because Jesus Christ did obey all the laws, and we are in him, and he in us, then we become the inheritors of all that Abrahamic blessing, and we find ourselves having already been forgiven of any sin or trespasses against his commandments that we might broken. Now, does that mean that you can live any way you want to and still be blessed? Probably not. Yes, you're still going to get to go to heaven because the curse, this is the difference. You see, the Old Testament law had blessings and cursings. If you follow my word and my ways, then I will bless you, the Lord said. And if you fail to follow my ways, then there are curses that will come upon you. The most notable curse is the wages of sin is death. That's a curse. The wages of sin is death. Wow. Death came upon all men.
Others to not grow. We miss opportunities to have blessing if we do not do the revealed word of God that he's given to us. But if we do, the sky is the limit on blessing. The sky is the limit. There is no limit to the blessings that God could bless you personally with if we turn the key and unlock the blessing by simply loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, whatever that is, and loving your neighbor as yourself, whatever that is. It's something we do intentionally, and it's something we do by faith. It doesn't just fall upon you. Yes, sometimes the blessings run and overtake you if you believe in them. If you have opened the door to the blessings, they'll come rushing out at you. But if you do not believe, then you do not have. Getting ahead of myself. Obedience here was accomplished by Christ in Galatians 3, not us. But believing and following Christ is our responsibility. And the rest of it I already said. Let's move on to number 4. Clearly, I'm not going to get done with this one either. The Apostle John prayed that Gaius would be prosperous and healthy. If you're filling in the blanks, there's your two words. The Apostle John prayed that Gaius would be prosperous and healthy. Maybe you don't know how to spell prosperous. It's P-R-O-S-P-E-R-O-U-S. Prosperous. Maybe you don't know how to spell it, not because it's multisyllabic, but rather because you haven't been there in a while. How do you spell that again? We're talking about the will of God for you. How do we know the will of God? Through the Word of God. Who wrote the Word of God? Holy men of God wrote and Scripture as God inspired them to write. Who in the New Testament were the writers of the New Testament? The apostles were. Who was the last man standing among the apostles? The Apostle John. And the Apostle John, writing to the church in his old age, some of the last scriptures that would ever be given out before the close of the New Testament era, said this, "Hey, Gaius." Or you can just say, "Hey, guys." Hey, Billy. Hey, Bob. Hey, Joni. Hey, Martha. Listen to this. He says, "Here's something I've been praying about. I'm not praying for the orphans. I'm not praying for the overthrow of the Roman government. I'm not praying for a new building for the church. He says, this is what I'm praying for. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health." What's the worth of your money if you're not healthy enough to enjoy it? Now, maybe John was just a nice guy. Maybe John just meant well. Maybe John always opened his letters that way. But here's the problem. God decided this would be Scripture. God decided this letter would be Scripture, spoken and inspired through His Holy Spirit, through the mouth of His Apostle John, and we receive it as Scripture. And as Scripture, then we learn something about the will of God in our lives. And what do we learn? We learn that the apostle says that this is the apostle's doctrine. Where did they get it? From the Lord. What did the Lord want to say through the apostle's doctrine to us? I want something for you. What does he want? What do you want now, God? I gave it the office. What do you want, God? I want you to prosper. I want you to prosper in all things and be in health. Really? Really? You want me to be prosperous? You want me to be rich? You want me to be super blessed? Yes. That's awesome. When do we start? As soon as your soul prospers. Oh. Because I am way too lazy to turn that key. I would rather do without blessing than have to do that. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things. The car that you drive, the house that you live in, do you get the skimpy internet or do you get the big fat wideband internet? He wants you to be blessed in all things. That's His will for you. Really, Pastor? Are you sure you wanted just to go out on a limb and say that? Because I sure have seen a whole lot of not that. And I sure have been praying hard. And I got lots of faith. And Grandma was poor too. And she prayed like a madman. So are you sure about all that? Well, beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and even be in health, just as your soul prospers. As means in proportion to. As your soul is prospering, so my will for you is that you may prosper in all things and be in health. Do you want to unlock the blessing of prosperity in God, of God in your life? Do you want to unlock the kind of blessing that John is praying for you here? And the way to do that, according to what it says, is that your soul prosper first. Well, how do you do that? Well, the soul is the part of you that lives forever. The soul is the non-physical part of you. The soul is the part that is eternal. What is good for the eternal? Think about things about heaven. Thinking about things that matter for a lifetime and beyond. Thinking about the things that matter more than just what I want to be about. When my soul begins to prosper, then my life will begin to prosper as well. Oh, great. So by the time my soul prospers and I become such a goody-two-shoes that I give all my money away, then I'm not going to be able to enjoy all the blessings because I will have been giving it all away. Yeah, let's just pretend you're a fire hydrant. Some of us are built like fire hydrants, don't they? And that the water is the word, is the blessings of God. You can be a water, you can attach a water fountain with a little bitty valve out of that, or you can open the side of that baby that blows the hoses of the fire trucks and really gushes and flows like crazy. You ever jump on one of those things? They open up the water to clean the pipes out, and you see little kids run out there, and they'll just jump in the stream of water and shoot across there, you know, because it's coming out at such a blessed amount, such a pressurized amount. He says, this is the kind of blessings I want on you. And you can do the water fountain kind of blessing, or you can do the fire hydrant kind of blessing. You decide. How much water do you want to release? How much of your fire plug do you want to open up to the will of God in your life? How much of the pressurized, unbelievably, no end to the amount of His blessing can possibly come out of you? If you open a fire hydrant, does it run out of water? No, it doesn't. Now, you might feel like it should or might, but I promise you, if you go out there and find a water hydrant, you open that baby up and you just let it run. And you just stand there in amazement at how it runs. And you just watch your watch a while and say, how long is it going to run at that same pressure? That is amazing. It's like it never runs out. It's like God's blessing. It never runs out. Until the cops show up. And they explain to you that you shouldn't be wasting water like that. But God's flow is infinite. God doesn't send the water police to shut you down. God doesn't send the blessing police to shut you down. Now, in church, you might find blessing police. The blessing police are, yeah, but. Okay, that's the words I start with. Yeah, but. Yeah, but does God really want me to be rich? I'd feel guilty. Yeah, but. See, those are the blessing police that want to rob you of the blessing. But the blessing of God is infinite. And the more we open to Him, the more He gives. The Apostle John prayed for Gaius to be prosperous and healthy. Being a Christian does not guarantee earthly prosperity. Earthly prosperity seems to be second in priority to our spiritual priority. Galatians chapter 3, verse 9 says, "So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham." So then those who are of faith. He didn't say those who go to church are blessed with believing Abraham. It didn't say those who heard this message are blessed. He says those who are of faith. So faith is directly involved with your blessing. You cannot receive blessing if you do not believe for it. Faith is the key that opens the door. Remember this. It's a very important thing to remember. As you see horrible events happen in the world, people say, how could God let that happen? Have you seen how kids are starving in places? How could God let that happen? I promise you, the Word of God has revealed that God's hand is not moved according to need. And it is not moved according to greed. It is moved by faith. Now, it doesn't rhyme, but it's still true. He's not going to be moved by your greed. Oh, God, please, please give me that thing I want so bad. I want that big screen TV because my 5-footer is just too small for the big game. He's not going to be moved by greed. If your TV dies completely and you say, oh, God, the playoffs are on. I need a TV. You see how I need it. God's like, huh, I already know the score. You want to tell the score ahead of time? I already know it. No, don't tell me. He's not moved by need, and he's not moved by greed, but he is moved by faith. Faith unlocks the blessing. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. Your faith takes priority over your earthly blessings. When we, by faith, grow in our soul, when our soul begins to prosper because our faith begins to grow, and our faith begins to grow because we've been exposed to more and more of the Word of God, because the Bible says that faith comes by hearing the Word of God, and the more we hear from the Word of God, the more we speak to God, the more we begin to foster this relationship with God, the more we encourage our soul to grow and prosper in God, that creates more faith, and faith unlocks the key of blessing, and then the blessing comes out. Oh, I get it now. First, I got to be all full of faith, and then God will bless me. No, God blesses fools and little children as well, because He does what He wants to. God is not a cosmic vending machine who causes us to get it all figured out. If I could just memorize just the right scriptures, if I could just do just the right thing. That's why He says, I want you to be blessed as your soul prospers, not as you learn the favorite key faith scriptures. Now, why am I picking on that point? Because I've seen people rise to levels of faith because they've learned certain key faith principles. And then whenever God doesn't do what they expected, when God has something else going on, when God says, no, not yet, not now, and the key faith scriptures seem to fail, then their faith begins to fail. Their walk with God begins to diminish. Their relationship with a God who has let them down, clearly, has been injured and harmed, so they think. But see, he says, I want you to prosper in all things as your soul prospers. One of those things, one of the most important of those things, is faith and believing. But there are two kinds of faith. This is Steve Goodner's opinion. This is not something I found in book, chapter, and verse 4, but having studied Scripture and understand what I know, this is Steve Goodner for a minute, right? There are two kinds of faith, in my opinion. There is active faith, and there is passive faith. Active faith says, mountain be thou removed and cast into the sea. That is an active faith. Cancer be cursed and go back to hell from you came from. That is an active faith. And then there's the faith that says, I have no idea what God's up to. But I know that he has my best in mind. I don't know what I'm going to do, but I know it's going to be okay. That's called passive faith. Passive means I take my hands off, and God's going to do what he's going to do. Now, which is the better faith? You see, that's why it's Steve Goodner's opinion, because the Scripture doesn't make a distinction between the two. There is a passive faith that believes God's going to take care of all things. And then there's the active faith that sometimes turns certain keys and makes things happen. But whenever my keys don't seem to work anymore, what do? I guess I fall back on my passive faith that says, though he slay me still, I will serve him. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that says that God is going to deliver us from the fiery furnace, but if not, we still will not bow to your gods. We still will not give up on our faith. We don't understand it, but I have a passive faith that will guide me through the hardest of times. And that is the kind of prospering in your soul that God wants you to have. And as you learn how to do the active faith, little keys of things that unlock doors and move mountains and curse cancer and all those cool things, when things don't work out for you, do not let your faith be destroyed. Do not sit back and say, wonder where God is. Is he on a coffee break? Does he hate me now? Was I not good enough? Are the curses coming on me? Did I do something wrong to offend him? Just trust your Heavenly Father that all things work together for good to them who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. All things work together for good. Number five, Jesus commands blessings over his people. The Apostle John prayed for the blessings on you. Number five, Jesus commands blessings over his people. You find here in Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 12, it says, this is Jesus' own words. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. By the way, I want you to notice a pattern going on here. He starts with a bad situation and shows how it's going to be. Does God want me to be blessed? Yes. Is it happening right now? Maybe not. Maybe not. But it's still scriptural. It's still scriptural. We may be down, we are not defeated. Though we may be harmed, we are not always going to be there. Though we may be sick, we're still going to get well. Though we may be broke, God will still supply all our need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Notice how many times he talks in the future tense to people who says, you are blessed right now. Blessed are, not blessed will be. He didn't say you're going to be blessed as soon as the goods start coming out the pipe. You're going to start being blessed as soon as you can see financial blessing pouring in. You'll be blessed as soon as you feel better in your body. He didn't say that. He says, blessed are you, present tense, about things that are still to come. That's called faith. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, because they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. You mean all this time I've been broke and been blaming God and thinking I'm not blessed? I had no idea how blessed I am. Woohoo! I'm broke and I'm sick. And I'm scared and I'm so blessed. I didn't know. It's still true. It's still true. The Word of God is still true. But Jesus said, he says that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That's why you have these scriptures in your hand, because I want you to have all of it. All of it I can cram into the paper. All that'll fit. I want you to have in your hands, because all of them are important. They shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. That doesn't sound very blessed. for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. Heaven? That blame, I thought he was talking about here on earth. Oh, he is also that. But if we fail to recognize that if all we get is the blessing of heaven, I'm not saying that's true, I'm just saying, if we fail to realize that, if that's all there is, how blessed are we? How blessed are we? Blessed are you when they persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. There's a couple of kinds of blessings in there. Some that come because of accidents in your life, and some because you are intentional. You see, some of the accidental ones, it says, though you may be in mourning, you will be comforted. Did anybody choose to be in mourning? No. Death happens at times that are inconvenient, at times that you don't expect. Those are things that happen to you. And if bad things happen to you, he says you're blessed already. And then there's things where it says, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness. That's something you do. That's something you cultivate. That's something you generate. Blessed are the merciful. That's something you do. Blessed are the peacemakers. That's something you do. And when you do those things, he says, then you're blessed also. I think it goes right back to when your passive faith is in effect, you're blessed. And when your act of faith is in effect, you're blessed. Well, when are the times that I'm not blessed? When we don't have any faith. That's when. Blessings are God's will for all who need any sort of blessing. And the gospel means good news and is the central message of Christianity. If your Christian message to your friends and your family and your neighbors is not good news, then, my friend, you are not preaching the gospel. I encourage every one of you, I would so love to see every one of you here Thursday night, learning how to lead your neighbors and your friends to Jesus. We're going to have a soul-winning clinic here on Thursday night. And I would love for every one of us to be here to learn how to lead somebody to Jesus. I don't know how many is going to actually show up, but I bet it won't be this many. But I wish that all of us could be here and could be a part of that blessing and a part of learning how to learn how to share good news with someone else. But it's got to be good news. If you go fishing, you can't just hang a big old bait hook out there. You got to have some bait on it. There's got to be some benefit from it. The gospel is good news. Gospel means good news and is central to the message of Christianity. Good news to a hungry man is that he will be fed. Good news to a sick person is that he will be healed. That's part of the gospel. It's part of the good news. A gospel that is not a message of hope is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think I'm going to stop there, because the next part is blessings are your birthright. And I've got five examples, and I don't want to stop after one, because I'm going to want to keep on going. And so since I'm like a whole 4 minutes before 12, what do I do with this? What do I do with all my time? Huh? Bless you? Well, we'll close with a blessing. Why don't we stand for a few minutes? And since we have a few minutes, let me take them. And let's just marinate in some of the words of God. And if I say blessing over you, recognize that they do not come from me, that they come from God. So let me just read some of that scripture again. Let me read that blessing of Abraham over you and bless you with that. And as I read it, I want you to receive it. How do I receive it? I don't know. Stick your hands out. I don't know. Open your ears up. I don't know. Say, Lord, I receive, I receive, I receive, I receive. Do whatever. But be in an attitude of prayer. Don't look at me. Look to God. I'm just going to be the prophet. I'm just going to be the mouthpiece of the message of God for a moment. And I'm going to read His message to you. And here's your challenge. Every time I read a blessing, under your breath, or in your own thoughts, or out loud if you want to, hey, Lord, I receive it. I receive that. Now, the challenge for you is if you're a bad person, you're going to be greedy. And if you're a good person, you're going to be, oh, not me, Lord. No, no, I don't deserve that. And so everybody's going to go away not blessed. Which one do you want to be? Neither. You want to be the one that says, thank you, Lord, may I have another. Let's try that for a moment. Maybe that's what we should say. Thank you, Lord, may I have another. Let's try it again. Thank you, Lord, may I have another. Aren't you glad the Lord's not a drill instructor? You can close your eyes, you can open your eyes. I want to read this blessing of Abraham. So it shall be when the Lord your God brings you into the land which he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you large and beautiful cities which you did not build, houses full of all good things which you did not fill, hewn out wells that you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees which you did not plant. When you have eaten and are full, amen, then beware lest you forget the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. You shall fear the Lord your God and serve him, and shall take oaths in his name. You shall not go after other gods, the gods of the people who are all around you. For the Lord your God is a jealous God among you. Lest the anger of the Lord your God be aroused against you to destroy you from the face of the earth, thanking God again that that curse was taken by Jesus on the cross. You shall not tempt the Lord your God as you tempted him in Massah. You shall diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God, his testimonies and his statutes which he has commanded you, and you shall do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may be well with you, and that you may go in and possess the good land of which the Lord swore to your fathers, to cast out all of your enemies from before you, as the Lord has spoken. Now it shall come to pass, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully all of his commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above the nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you because you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shall you be in the city, and blessed shall you be in the country. Blessed shall be the fruit of your body and the produce of the ground and the increase of your herds, the increase of your cattle and the offspring of your flocks. Blessed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies who rise against you to be defeated before your face. They shall come out against you one way and shall flee before you seven different ways. The Lord will command blessing on you in your storehouses and in all which you set your hand. And he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. The Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself, just as he has sworn to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. Then all the people of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. And the Lord will grant you plenty of goods and the fruit of your body, in the increase of your livestock, and in the produce of your ground, in the land of which the Lord swore to your fathers to give you. The Lord will open to you his good treasure, the heavens, to give you the rain to your land in its season, and bless all the work of your hand. You shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. And the Lord will make you the head and not the tail. You shall be above only and not beneath, if you heed the commandments of the Lord your God, which I have commanded you this day, and are careful to observe them. Lord, may we be careful to observe all the commandments that you have given us. And Lord Jesus, you have simplified those for us. You said if we would love the Lord our God with all our heart and all our soul, and with all our mind and with all our strength, and Lord, if we would love our neighbor as ourself, then we would have fulfilled all the law. We thank you, Lord, that you have kept us from the curse of the law because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross for us. I just want to wait there just a moment before we go into the receiving and thankfulness for the blessing. We thank you, Lord, that you took the curse of the law on yourself for us. With every head bowed and every eye closed just for a moment, if you were here, maybe for the first time today or the first time that you're just paying attention to this message, but you want the blessing of God in your life and you want it to start with the eternal. You want to start by making sure that your place in heaven is secure. That if you died today, that you know for sure that you would go to heaven. That is the first and greatest gift of God. It's called eternal life. If you don't have eternal life, you have nothing. But if you have eternal life through Jesus, you have everything. That's where we start. If you would like to begin a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, by asking Him to come into your heart and save you, that will result not only in eternal life, but all these blessings we spoke of. If you've never done that before, if you've never had your sins forgiven, then today's a great time to do that. And it's real easy. You don't have to get all the words right. You don't have to get all the jargon correct. You don't have to understand everything we've talked about. We just need to understand that we've done wrong. I've done wrong. And that God sent His Son Jesus to take the punishment for my wrong. And if you'd like that forgiveness today, would you just raise your hand quickly in the quietness of the moment, every head bowed, every eye closed. Say, would you help me with that, Pastor? I want to be saved today. I want God to save me. Amen. All right. Well, if you want to do that, I don't see any hands up this morning that other than maybe one just making sure, and that's always good. Then I want to challenge us. Who did you invite this week? Oh, the negativity, wasn't it? No, it's some positivity about the good news. We want to fill this place with people who have not heard the gospel as well as those who want to be blessed by what they heard today. Then, Lord, the next thing we want to say is thank you for your blessing. Thank you for the blessing of Abraham. Thank you for eternal life through Jesus, which is just the beginning. Thank you for faith in the scriptures that teach us how to unlock the blessings of Abraham in our life. Thank you, Lord, that you've taken the curse of the law, but you have opened opportunity for us to be blessed beyond measure as our soul prospers. And so, Lord, since we understand that our financial and our earthly blessings will not occur except as our soul prospers, then we want to start there. And so, Lord, I yield myself to you, and I pray that you would help my soul to prosper. I pray that you would feed my soul with good things from your word. I pray that you would help me to make good choices in my soulish nature, Lord, that would put out the bad and negative things and receive only the good things from God. Lord, I pray that you would help me to prosper in my soul because you help me to make choices that say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Lord, would you help me to prosper in my soul? And Lord, thank you that your will, of course, is that you bless us beyond that. But Lord, bless us in our soul. And Lord, for those who are in need today, for those who this is really good news message today because they are really in dire straits, Lord, we say blessings, Father. We call on the hand of the Father that has promised to meet all of our need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And we command the blessing through the name of Jesus Christ against our bills and against those things that of enemy that rise up against us. We speak blessing in the name of Jesus. And we say that God has supplied all my need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We receive your provision gratefully in Jesus' name. And we look forward to the miraculous way you've done that. In Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray that by the time we get to the part where we have all things richly to enjoy, that you would help us to give you thanks. That you would help us to give you praise. You would help us to glorify and praise you, Lord, and that we would find more joy in the worship of the God who gave us the gifts than we would in the gifts themselves. Let us not be little children when it comes to thankfulness about gifts. Let us be big enough kids to remember that the relationship with the Father is the greatest thing, and we thank you for the gifts that come beyond that. Lord, these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, see, I knew I could do something to get us past 12 o'clock. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you. May He lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. And you are blessed in the city. And you are blessed in the field. And you are blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Let's make it three. Who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Go in His blessing today. God bless you.